the office current thickness. Hubert and I grow actually up in the same metropolitan region. But he on the German side and I'm from the Austrian side. He went to the Academy of Applied Arts in Vienna, the Masterklasse Hans Holland. And you know, after you know, we met several times in Salzburg, but after I left you, I didn't see you anymore. You went to New York, and in New York you met Alfredo, and you started at Columbia, and then you went to Venezuela, you're married. Your wife is from Venezuela, and every time you meet Hubert, it's like it's always a big story. You know, he always has a fantastic story. One time he was robbed in Venezuela, and he talked so much to the robbers that they said, you know, and he told them that he did this kind of social project for them already, and they were so surprised that they robbed the wrong one in a way, because they wanted to have somebody where they get money out, and they didn't expect somebody who was giving so much effort to the locals. And they let him out again without any money, and they were taking care that he's safe out of the car. Anyway, so he always has good stories, he's well connected in the world, and I'm very happy that he was becoming a professor at the ETH Zurich, and since this year he's also the chair of the ETH Zurich. So please welcome Hubert Klumpner.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you. Let me see how I do this. Yes, well, I plug in here. The story with the guys who kidnapped me actually was that after a while they brought me up in the barrios, favelas of Caracas, and after a while they decided that I can leave now, and I said, well, then thanks, then I can go. And they said, we can't let you go because it's too dangerous here. So they brought me back to my house. So this is a real story, and I tell you stories like this. You have to earn, they're not for free. And I want to tell you a story now, and I hope it's interesting for you, about 1 billion people living in slums today. We hear it every day. There's a demographic growth. There's also a demographic shift. There's also economic models that maybe not here in Vorarlberg. I hear you have very low unemployment rates, but we work right now in Athens, which is a disastrous situation. You know, I met the dean of Lisbon Architecture School. People are leaving the country because there's no work. And I can tell you, the places where we have worked, where Fred and I have worked in the last years, they are below the existence minimum. This is a word that almost you are familiar with the term of Neudeutsch. Existence minimum is actually used now already in English. It's the minimum that the government thinks you can still exist. Anybody knows what that is in Europe? What's the existence minimum in Austria, Germany? Any numbers? What do you think? Very close. It's just a little bit below 1,000. So what do you think a person in Caracas makes? What's the existence minimum in Caracas? Just to get a, to level out our minds before we enter this other world. Sorry?
80.
It's 50. It's $50. $50 a month, gross income. And I'm talking about a number of people. It's 1 billion, everybody knows it. It's a big number. It's about the population of China or India. It's 1 billion people living in slums. And Alfredo and I, after graduating in Columbia University, we said to ourselves, this is not only a challenge far beyond architecture, it's a challenge for our society. It's a challenge for politics, for politicians. It's a question of governance, but it's also a question of science and technology, and certainly also of culture and of architecture. And this is why I went to Venezuela. In Venezuela, I met a lot of very interesting people. This gentleman here on the left is my father-in-law, Kai Rosenberg. He went to South America a few years earlier. He's actually from Hamburg. He's from a Jewish family. He left Germany during the Second World War. He was was adopted by a Venezuelan family, and much in the style of Claude Lévi-Strauss, he went into the jungle. And I'm telling you this story because it is relevant. It is relevant because at that time, the green spots in the globe, on the globe, the terra incognita, the unknown world, that was a place that people wanted to figure out how it works and what's actually going on there. On an anthropological level, but also on the level we heard it before, seeds, plants, the pharmacy of the rainforest, we know a lot about it. What we don't know a lot about is how cities work. You know, I'm teaching urban design at the ETH in Zurich. I'm the dean of the school, and when I was at my interview, I told the president that nobody really knows how to make cities. If anybody claims, and much of those presentations at this hearing for who will get this new chair at the ETH, they were like a beauty contest. There were people there from the Netherlands, from England, sorry, but they were also there, from Germany, from the United States, and they all told everybody they knew how to make the city of the future. I can tell you, nobody has an idea because there's no basic research that has been done. We cannot work in those cities and we cannot build architectural projects anymore on the basis of what we know so far. That has to do with infrastructure that is not integrated, that is actually failing. And while we're sitting here in this very nice building, the water tubes of our houses are rottening, and I can tell you the infrastructural ideas from the 19th and 20th century are not working anymore in the cities of the future. We have to rethink our entire approach to house the people, and that is also why this project is not a philanthropic project. It is true we don't make money with it. We're getting now a paycheck from the university, but with the projects that we are doing since more than 10, 15 years, we have never made money, but we have found people who are financing them. And this is a big shift because we break in those dichotomies that exist, that poor people can't have good projects, that cheap stuff is for the poor, and wealth will get good quality buildings. I will show you a few buildings and I will show you a few ideas, and people have criticized us that we made first class, first world buildings in slum zones. But I can tell you there's a good reason for it. We made sports centers that had in the first month 15,000 visitors a month. I don't know how many visitors do you have in this museum per month?
Less.
You see? So we need good materials. I think you would agree. If you have 15,000 people walking through your building, you need good materials. They have to be appropriate, but they certainly have to be of very good quality, and you have to think very hard how to put them in place. So this is why we didn't go in the rainforest. This is, by the way, Lothar Baumgarten. You might know him because he's a well-known artist, now teacher in Berlin. He spent a lot of time in Venezuela also. But Kai and Lothar went to the jungle to see the Indians. I saw my first Indian in Caracas, in the middle of the city. This is actually a woman from the Bayou tribe on the Colombian border, Alejandro. You might know that. Alejandro is from Colombia. And it shows you also a phenomenon which is very different to what people knew so far about what's actually going on in cities. So I'm introducing you a bit in this world. Because in the past, people have assumed that just like in London and Paris, Gustave Doré made those etchings, you know, the tale of two cities, that people will go into cities, they will find work there, and there will be an upward mobility, and they will do better. I can tell you, people go into cities, and there's no work. There's no perspective that they will find a job, and they will probably end up on the street, and a lot of them end up in slum areas. And we know now after 10 years, because we have the numbers, we studied the cases, they stay there. They go into slum areas and they live there for generations. There's no upward mobility. A good friend of ours, Jeffrey West from the Santa Fe Institute, look him up. He's dealing actually with big data and complex systems. He's a mathematician. We work very closely with him because he can run those numbers. And he came up with something that you can read in all science magazines. Cities are machines of wealth, but they're also machines of poverty. It is well known that as much as they create mobility opportunities, they also create congestion. They create wealth, but they also create crime. There's a dichotomy, a symmetry, and if we don't understand what's going on in our cities also Bregenz has that question on the desk, I would say, just like anybody else in the world has to answer that question. If we don't look at those places, we will have big problems down the road. So this is actually Calcutta. You see a bridge that is almost 100 years old. It's the only bridge over the river. They only have one bridge, and infrastructure is failing. This is quite interesting because we have found that it is infrastructure which is actually our entry gate. Why? Because nobody really spends money in architecture in those cities. Architecture is a luxury for most of the people. Infrastructure, engineers come first. If you go to South America, they will like actually tell you an architect is a guy who is too much sissy to become an engineer, but he's too much gay, not gay enough to become an interior designer. So architects are not very highly seen, and it's engineers who will rule the world, and we have figured out that if you want to make a change, you actually have to work on the system of integrated infrastructure. We have to piggyback, we have to sit on the infrastructural projects that are landing in our cities and often destroying them, let's not forget about that. Highway distributors, channeling of water, energy lines, and all that comes out of your faucet and out of your plug does not exist in those cities. Those are investments that have to be made, and companies like Siemens, like Zumthor, like Doppelmayr just here in Vorarlberg are also interested in this, and this is why after a short introduction I show you three concrete projects that translate what I just tell you into the real world, what translates those ideas which what we call a toolbox with concrete projects into reality. So this is a map actually done by Christian Bertmann. He is chairing in 2 weeks in Munich, if anybody is around, the UN Habitat Forum at the TU Munich. And this map shows black is the geographical footprint of the continent and blue is the demographic footprint. So the demographic numbers indicate that actually, and everybody knows it, also a lot of architects work now for the aging. That is also interesting in wealthy societies, but I can tell you the societies where there's a growth of population, it's mostly young people. I'm sure you have heard that too. So I would like to put this lecture under the rubric of a wake-up call. This is actually graffiti that you see all over Athens. We are working at the moment with the Onassis Foundation in Athens, because both the big foundation in Athens, they have started to sponsor an opera house done by Renzo Piano, and the Onassis Foundation made a big landscape project, a green and public space project, and they figured out in the last 2 or 3 years that both projects will make no change in the city. They stopped these projects, and they're figuring out now, we try to help them on this quest to make something that translates the challenges of the society, the challenges of the economy, of the urban economy, of the regional economy, into a governance idea through design, through urban design and architecture. So you probably heard that line before because it is almost on every book. You find it even on cornflakes boxes and in advertisement slogans that 50% of the people live in cities. Anybody knows who actually came up with that observation? Who was the first one who found that out? Any ideas? Where did you read that first or hear that first? But you heard about that, right? Anybody heard about that before, that 50% of people live in cities? Well, in architecture circles, you hear it over and over again. It's one of the no-go zones. You don't start a lecture with that anymore. I tell you, Eric Hobsbawm was the one who came up with it. He's actually a historian. He died 2 years ago. I had the pleasure, together with Alfredo, to meet him. He was born in Alexandria. He lived in Vienna and Berlin, and he died in London. And in his book, The Age of Extremes, he wrote two things. One was, and here's the first error, he said actually, and that's the true thing, we changed from being a rural society to being an urban society. Because I tell you here that the line that 50% of people live in cities is actually not true. We live in urban environments, we don't live in cities. So, you know, there's a big confusion of terms here also. People pick terms and they use them over and over again. they don't live in cities. They live in urban environments, which is quite different. But that is not that important. The more important thing is that the other line, also coming from Eric Hobbs Baumann, he wrote it for us on a piece of paper, and I share with you here. An idea that he had was a sort of an advice for all of you that I share with you was, if humanity is to have a recognizable future, it cannot be prolonging the past or the present. Social distribution and not growth will dominate the politics of the new millennium. So this is not a neo-Marxist concept, and I like to share that also with you. It is an idea, actually, that biologists and a lot of economists are also trying to figure out how we can actually have a growing economy by sharing. And maybe some of you already are members of a car sharing club, and even the people who built the cars were getting somehow nervous about it, right? Mercedes made his own car sharing system. So sharing versus producing more and more and throwing it away. So this is a big rubric that I like to put over the place I live. I introduce you to my hometown. You don't find postcards in Caracas because there's nothing to put on them. So we made our own ones. This is one postcard. And you see, this is what we call the barrios. In other places in Brazil, they call them favelas.